Hello, foamers and continuum mechanics enthusiasts. My name is Philip Cardiff and I'm an assistant professor in University College Dublin in Ireland. Let me start by thanking Josef for organising this event. I think it's great and I look forward to watching the other talks. So for my talk, I'm going to talk about the implementation of mesh smoothing approaches in OpenFoam. So this is related to some work I've been doing recently. Let me start with some background and motivation. So we all know that the mesh quality directly affects the solution quality. So why specifically would we consider smoothing the mesh? Well, for one, we might want to improve the quality of our initial mesh. So if we see this picture of a T component on the right, I initially created this mesh in block mesh, but then it'll have quite straight lines. So I ran a mesh smoothing algorithm on it, and then it increased the quality of the mesh where there were some severe shear angles here. A second reason we might want a mesh smoother is to maintain the mesh quality during moving mesh simulations. So for example, ALE or arbitrary Lagrangian ordering. So in this video, it shows the Hron-Torric FSI fluid solid interaction test case. So we have a solid cantilever beam, so that's fully Lagrangian, it doesn't need a mesh motion solver, but the fluid mesh here has to move and be smoothed to accommodate for the moving boundary of the solid interface. So in this case, it's using the built-in OpenFoam Laplacian method. So for these mesh smoothing options, like the ones in OpenFoam, the motion of the internal domain is driven by the motion of the boundaries. So you're trying to distribute the boundary motion across the internal domain. I'm going to look at some mesh smoothing options where the boundaries aren't moving, we're just trying to redistribute the internal points. So some important mesh metrics: face non-orthogonality. So if we take two adjacent cells and we join their centers with a line and we compare that line with the face normal, if they're at an angle, this angle measures how non-orthogonal that face is. So ideally we want this normal to be parallel to this line. A second type of error is can come from skewed faces. So if we take this line between the two cell centers, we can see it is parallel to the normal in this case, and so it's not non-orthogonal, but this line doesn't go through the face center. So that means it can introduce some skewness. So both of these things can reduce the order of accuracy and the absolute accuracy of the final volume discretization. Specifically, the goal of this project it's to develop a robust mesh smoothing component that will be built into an ALE solid mechanics solver for metal forming simulations. So, for example, solving drawing and rolling simulations. So that's where we're aiming. So just to mention, this project is in collaboration with Bekaert. So Bekaert are a global expert in the manufacture of high strength steel wire. And I'm fortunate in this project to work with their engineers in their headquarters in Belgium. All right, so let's set out the challenge. So here we see a very simple 2D mesh, which is skewed and non-orthogonal internally. So the question, or the aim, or the challenge for a mesh smoother is, can we redistribute these mesh points or vertices in some way to improve the mesh quality? One thing to point out here, I'm only talking about moving mesh vertices. I'm not talking about any topological changes, i.e. I'm not trying to change the connectivity of the mesh. So I'm not going to add points or faces or edges. I just want to move the points. So one of the most basic mesh smoothing procedures out there is called the point-based Laplacian method. It's also called Gaussian smoothing as well. So in this approach, let me first get some naming conventions down. So I'm going to call the center point here that I'm trying to move. I'll call that point P. So XP here represents the coordinates of this point. XN1 represents the coordinates of neighbor 1, XN2, neighbor 2, neighbor 3, neighbor 4. And then the superscript I here represents iteration number. So we're going to iteratively move all of these points. So we'll move this point to I plus 1, then I plus 2, etc., etc. So point-based Laplacian method says that our new coordinate for XP, so I plus 1, our new one, is just going to be some weighted average of its nearest neighbors. So these weights could be calculated many different ways. The most simple is just to use an arithmetic average. So in this case, it's basically saying that this new center point, the new position, just the average of the four nearest neighbors. So that would put it somewhere there. So when we move that point, you can see we end up with a good quality mesh. So even though the method's quite simple, it actually works quite well. And the algorithm's quite easy to implement as well. So this is just a pseudo code. You just go through all the internal points of the mesh, defining the new point as 0, 0, initialize it to 0, go through all the nearest neighbors, and then we just add on the contribution from that nearest neighbor. Just to point out, you have to be careful with boundary points. You probably only want the boundary points to slide along the boundary. You don't want the volume of your domain to change. And also, when you're coding it for in parallel, you just have to be careful when you're calculating the weights on processor-to-processor boundaries and make sure you do that correctly. So if we look at an example, this is like the plate hole tutorial test case. So it was a mesh made in block mesh with five different blocks, one here, 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 and here. And I purposely made the mesh quality, initial mesh quality bad just to test, to make it more of a test for the mesh simulator. So if I play it, and we can see the point-based Laplacian, after running about 100 iterations, it's starting to converge. I think maybe we could even run it for maybe 400 or 500 more before we see it fully stop moving, but it produces quite a nice mesh. One thing to note is this Laplacian method, in regions of that are concave, it tends to make the cells smaller in those regions and larger in convex regions. That's just one artifact of the method. Just looking at the literature at other methods out there, mesh smoothing methods are often used in the graphics field. And to overcome this shrinkage that the Laplacian smoothing method has, this Taubman expansion step is often used. So the idea behind a Taubman expansion step is we first do a Laplacian step. So it looks slightly different than before, but actually this is just an equation for under relaxation. So we're saying the new coordinate is the old coordinate plus some relaxation or scale factor times the displacement. So we take this Laplacian step, but rather than taking the full step, we just take a fraction of it. And then in the next step, we do a so-called Taubman step, where we apply a negative factor. So we shrink it a little bit and smooth it, and then we push the points back in the direction they came from. And that's described here. So what happens when you use this? It means that you don't get any shrinkage. So we can see if I play it, not much happens here. I'm starting with a much nicer mesh, but you can see it's just moving these points here to try improve the quality here. The reason I didn't show the worse mesh is because it actually just isn't as robust and it just diverges. So adding this Taubman option, okay, it seems to help a little bit if you're on a already quite good mesh, but it seems to make it less robust. It's also pretty straightforward to implement. This lambda and mu values here, these are what Taubman recommends in his original papers. So it's a similar loop for calculating the new point as before, and then at the end we just say if it's a Laplacian step, then we apply a shrinkage, Otherwise, if it determines that, then we apply an expansion. The next method I looked at was point-based Laplacian smoothing with cell volume weights. So this method I have came across it being used quite a number of times in finite element and ALE methods for large elastoplastic deformations. So softwares like Abacus use it for their robust ALE, for their default ALE mesh smoothing method, and also softwares like LS-Dyna. So this method is similar to the other ones, except instead of using the adjacent points, we use the adjacent cells. So we'll say the new coordinate for the center point here, the blue point, will be the weighted average of the adjacent cell centers. So we're using the cell centers instead of the adjacent points. So how will we calculate the weights? You could take an arithmetic average, but it seems that the method that is most commonly used is to calculate the weights based on the volumes of the cells. So what that means is, rather than just moving this center point to the average position of the four cell centers, which would be somewhere here, instead we're going to move it a little bit closer to this top left cell, because this top left cell has a larger volume. So it's weighting the motion to move towards the larger volume cells. So if I try this on the more simple mesh example, it seems to do a pretty good job. Quite similar to Laplacian, except it doesn't produce the same small cells here, so that's good. Let's try it on the more difficult example. I've said lambda here is 1, so this is like the under relaxation factor that I'm applying. So there's no under relaxation here. So once again, it converges. So it converges to the exact same answer. It requires some more iterations. Also, if I just play it again, you'll see that it has this kind of vibration. But it still converges. So between two different iterations, it's kind of oscillating or jumping. So if I try the same case again and I drop the under relaxation factor, the scale factor, then you can see that that seems to mostly quell these oscillations. So it seems you can control the robustness of this explicit method using this scale factor. As an example, I also tried it on the Icofoam elbow on structured mesh, and it seems to work okay. But one thing that you can notice is the number of iterations tends to increase more and more, definitely as you increase the number of cells. So that can be one limitation of implementing these Laplacian smoothing methods explicitly. So now I'm going to go on to talk about how maybe we can do it implicitly. Just before that, just to show it is actually improving the mesh, if we looked at the max non-orthogonality before, for this test case it was 36 and the average was 11, and these smoothing iterations brought it down to 33 and 10, not a big change, and then the skewness went from 0.5 to 0.36. But it definitely helps. So to try look at maybe implicit versions of smoothing, I've considered doing a cell-based version of the volume-weighted Laplacian method. So the idea here, similar to before, but now instead of trying to move a point, let's try and move the cell center, or at least calculate where the new cell center should be. So CP here, the blue dot represents the cell center of our center cell, and then we have neighbor 1, that should be 2, that should be 3, and that should be 4, that's a typo. So this method I'm suggesting says the new cell center should be the weighted average of the closest nearest neighbors, where we'll calculate the volumes based on calculate the weights based on the volumes of the cells. The potential advantage of doing it this way instead of based on points is, if we write in terms of cell centers, then we can use the finite volume infrastructure within OpenFOAM. So it means we can write these smoothing equations implicitly rather than explicitly. Of course, the disadvantage is to move the mesh, we need to move the mesh points, but this method will give us the motion of the cell centers. So that means we have to average or interpolate the cell center motions to the points. So a simple method is just to use arithmetic average. There are other methods as well. So we could consider an explicit method like this, where we calculate a new cell center position for cell P based on the old, or I, so you can see I plus 1 on the left and I on the right, the old positions of surrounding cell centers. But to do it implicitly, we would say that the new position of cell center P depends implicitly on the new positions of the adjacent cells. So I've just moved this term to the left and multiplied by minus 1, and I've changed these in S index to be I plus 1 as well. So these are the unknowns. So if we take this equation, we substitute in the definition of the weights. We can take out this bottom sum. So if we multiply across by that sum, we get something that looks like a sum by the central cell center, and then plus a sum of the neighbor volumes by their cell centers. So you might recognize that this actually is definition of a discrete Laplacian operator. So before we write it in terms of a PDE, let's just manipulate it a little bit further. So one thing we can do is, instead of trying to calculate the new cell centers, I find it a bit more convenient if we just write the new cell center in terms of the original starting cell center plus some displacement vector. So I'd rather solve for a displacement vector than the original cell center. So we'll just do that for the cell P and also for the neighbors. So we know the original cell center, so let's just move all the knowns to the right. So we have all the cell center terms on the right, and then we have all the unknown displacements on the left. So now we can convert this to PDE form, so partial differential equation form. So on the left, this is the definition of a Laplacian of unknown displacement, u. So u represents displacement here, not velocity. And their diffusivity are the cell volumes. On the right hand side, we have Laplacian of our original cell centers. So I've called them x here. So it's a minus Laplacian of that. And once again, we have diffusivity of the cell volumes. Then if you look at this gradient of the cell centers, the original ones, by definition that is actually the identity matrix. And then we can go a step further, the divergence of a scalar by the identity is actually just equal to the gradient. So then our final PDE that we'll implement in OpenFOAM will be Laplacian unknown displacement, where the diffusivity are the cell volumes, which is equal to minus the gradient of the cell volumes. On the left, this is Laplacian displacements, where the cell volume field is diffusivity. This means that cells with smaller volumes will tend to increase in size or move more, so they're more flexible. And on the right hand side, the gradient of the cell volume field is the driving force. So that means that smaller cells will tend to move towards larger cells. So larger cells will tend to get smaller, and smaller cells will tend to get larger. Just to point out as well, cell volumes will change as a function of the displacement field. So this means this is actually a non-linear PDE, because V here is actually a function of U. As a starting simple linearization, we can just perform an iteration over this where we update the cell volumes each time. But to implement this in OpenFOAM, we can just write like this: implicit Laplacian cell volumes by displacement is equal to explicit minus an explicit gradient cell volumes, and we can perform an outer iteration where we update the cell volumes. So I'll take a relatively simple example again, check how the method works, and let me just perform one iteration. So when I perform just one iteration, all the cells will move quite a lot, and because the method is implicit, it's moving all the cells. We don't have the same limitation of an explicit method. And then when I go on and run it for some extra outer iterations, it corrects for the non-linearity in the PDE. So there's some regions here where it's just moving the cells around a little bit. So the method seems to work pretty well. You can see here some of the cells in near the central hole seem a bit elongated. But if we look at the cell volumes, so this is the initial cell volume field. So we have small volumes here in meters cubed, and then the cells out here are about three times as large. So when we run the smoother, you can see it straight away almost makes all the volumes the same cell. All the cells the same volume. So it is doing what it's meant to do. So the method seems to work okay. So to summarize, I've examined a number of explicit Laplacian-based smoothing methods and also an implicit cell-based Laplacian smoothing method. So the explicit point-based Laplacian with cell weight seems to be the most robust, it seems to work really well, whereas the implicit method is obviously faster. So if we could combine these in some way, seems like the best approach. The next steps then will be to try the smoothing method on more complex 2D and 3D meshes, and then to incorporate it as a component into an ALE solver for metal forming. So thanks very much for listening to my talk, and if you have any questions, I'm sure you can leave them in the comments.